Hello children, I'm delighted to discuss the novel tests here with you using the light board. I'm sure this is going to be a thrilling experience for me at least, for you too. So Tess, as we know, the novel is endearingly called Tess, but the novel actually is called Tess of the... I hope the writing is clear for you. Tess of the D'Urbervilles. And what is important about the title is that it has a subtitle too. The subtitle goes like this: The Story of a Pure Woman Faithfully Presented. So this is the more than the novel, it was a subtitle that created a controversy in England. The controversy was about the word pure there, where how a pure woman, what is shown in the novel is contrary to what the title is. And it is that which created this controversy in England. And you know who the author is. It is Thomas Hardy. And we jump right into the novel. I've structured the novel into three areas. One, I would like to tell you who the characters are. I'll write down the characters for you. The characters are Tess. She has to be there as she's the main character. We have Angel Claire, Alec D'Urberville. And we'll come to the minor characters later on. Now, the next thing that I want to tell you about the novel is the destinations of the novel, the locales, the places that the novel is centered around, the activities are centered around. So we have the first place is Marlott. The second is Tantridge. The third is Talbothays. And we have Flintcombe Ash. Actually, when I was observing the classes that have been taken here before, I used to wonder how the writing is coming about, how it is represented, how we see it on the other side. So it seems quite exciting to write like this, and the fact that you are seeing the corrected image on the other side of the camera. So these are the main locales, the destinations in the novel, and we go into the themes. So themes, which I will write as we go forward. So let's see what happens with these characters in these places. Now the main character Tess is an 18-year-old girl. She is married, she is the daughter of Joan and John Durbeyfield. So that's how the name goes in the beginning. It is Joan and John Durbeyfield who are the parents of Tess. And in the beginning of the novel, you see a poor family that is fighting for their daily bread and butter. Now the whole atmosphere of Tess of Thomas Hardy has been built upon an England that was suffering from depression of the 1870s. So what was happening in the world in Europe had affected England too, and England was responding in many ways to this depression. And as a result of that, we find a group of people who are very poor, who are struggling for their daily livelihood. And in this group of people, we single out the family of Tess. So they have, Tess has a brother and a sister. The sister's name is Lisa Lou. I think I'll write down her name also here. Lisa Lou, and a little brother who is not mentioned very much in the novel. You have another character who is not a human, but I'll write it's Prince. Prince is their horse, and I think the horse has a very important, a significant role to play in the novel, as we see that the prince is the source of livelihood for the family. So we have Tess here as a young girl who is ready to help her family by taking up the responsibility of doing certain things that need attention in the family. And that is how one day when John Derbyfield falls ill, she decides to help him by taking over certain responsibilities, and she decides to go on to the market, to the town, the market, to buy certain things in order to for their house, also to sell certain things that they produce, because what we see is an agricultural family, and so their means of livelihood is by selling certain produce, agricultural produce that they have, grow in or cultivate in their village. So she goes there to town. On the way back, somehow she falls asleep. She dozes off, and in fact she had her younger brother with her. She dozes off, and suddenly you find Prince, the horse, walking into some kind of a pit, losing his balance, and the whole cart along with Prince falls down, is overturned. We find the moment this happens, we know that tragedy has struck. Tess immediately recognizes the danger. Very soon, we see a different family in front of us. Now, meanwhile, there was something that needs to be mentioned, that her father, John Derbyfield, is not an enterprising person. He is just one among the people who submit to what is happening around. So the depression has affected him. He is partly a drunkard, partly responsible. So he is a father whom we cannot look up to. And there he suddenly realizes, or rather we see how John Derbyfield has heard from somewhere that he is part of a lineage, a noble lineage, which was the name Derbyville. And he finds that out, and from that moment onwards you see a Joan Derbyfield who wants to immediately take over the role, the new role that he's promised to be given. He has not, it has not been established, but yet he starts living that role. And maybe it is natural on his part, given the circumstances that England is facing, given the circumstances that he sees in the village around him. He sees it must be an act of bravery or an act of establishing himself that he decides to live the role that is promised to him. So from that moment onwards, he tries, he adopts the airs of a noble person. He starts calling himself d'Urberville and says he belongs to a great family who were once rich. So this is the kind of family that Tess has got, from where we find this tragedy happening, and Tess immediately is set to become the earning member of the family, because at the moment this prince dies, there is this notion or this idea in Tess that their life has ended, for that matter, their comfortable life. If they were comfortable or not is relative, but she feels that there is something that is going to happen that is forbidding. And Prince dies very soon. John Durbeyfield, alias d'Urberville, falls ill, he dies, and we see the mother, the sister, the brother, and the elder sister Tess left alone. Now Tess feels very responsible and guilty that she is the reason for the misfortune in the family, and she suggests that she will go out and work. And that is how we find Tess moving from Marlott, her native village, to Tantridge. Now Tantridge is the place where she finds a position for herself. In fact, she's promised a position for herself, because then the reason she goes is she finds that there is family there, in fact a mother and a son, who have the same name, d'Urberville, who belong, and she supposes, or other people tell her, that d'Urberville family is also, it's an extension of their family, and so it is with a hope of, with a great amount of hope, a great amount of expectation, and a sense of security that Tess goes to Tantridge. Because see, this is the first time a young girl Tess as a young girl is being exposed to the world outside. So she moves on to Tantridge. Now what happens there? You find Alec and his mother. He lives with his mother there. The mother, in fact, the father, Alec's father, is Mr. Stoke d'Urberville. Now we find later on that this was a false name that was adopted by Alec. Actually, Alec's father, Stoke d'Urberville, he has again this idea of the big family, the lineage, the nobility has struck him also, the same way it had struck John d'Urberville. So he has John d'Urberville could do nothing but boast about it, while Stoke d'Urberville does something better. He buys better, in the sense he buys the name. He pays money to get the name d'Urberville. So Stoke is no more there. We find only Alec and his mother. The moment Alec sees Tess, he wants to keep her there, and he takes pains in order to convince his mother that Tess can be appointed as a caretaker of their dairy. And their poultry. So they have a small business running side by side, and she is put in charge of that. From then on, we know what would happen. Tess is a very beautiful girl, very charming, a buxom girl. That's how she has been picturized in the films. And any picture of any picture, any cover page, any mention of Tess is always associated with the idea of a girl who is, of a young girl who is buxom, not the slim, trim or the thin girls that we see nowadays, which is the fashion. She is a village girl wearing a very flary kind of a dress, dressed in puffs and frills, as was the custom there. So that is the kind of Tess that we see, which is immediately endearing to someone who belongs to the town, who immediately feels or believes themselves to be sophisticated and dignified. She presents a lot of charm and a lot of sweetness and a lot of innocence, which actually is there in Tess. So that is how Alec d'Urberville starts pursuing Tess. So we see, as is formally, if we were asked to draw a plot or explain a plot of the unit, talk about the plot of Tess d'Urberville, it would be a triangular plot where you have Tess at the top and Angel and Alec on the three, on the lower, angles of the triangle. So we have Alec d'Urberville following Tess, and there is a scene. The whole novel begins with a May dance, a picture of a May dance, where Alec, Angel, Claire and Tess have a, they do not meet, but they have a glimpse of each other, which is not enough to for them to fall in love though. But we see Angel coming, appearing in the beginning of the novel, and then we see her interaction with Alec. Now, once on a journey into the forest, on a journey regarding their business, Alec escorts Tess to go to the town. They come back, and on their way back, they have Alec knowingly decides to stop in a forest, and he tells Tess that it was by mistake that they have lost their way, and so that is the reason for Tess being there. Anyway, for them being there, so they stop at this place, forest. Tess is very tired. She takes a nap, and it is during that time that Alec d'Urberville, it is raining. It is raining, and during that Alec takes that opportunity in order to rape Tess. So what we see here, the way Thomas Hardy describes the incident is a rainy forest. A rainy forest where there are trees and flowers and plants, and in the midst of them you find the epitome of innocence and purity, Tess, the very young girl who is unaware about the ways of the world, and you find her being raped by someone who is very specifically a symbol of modernity, a symbol of a kind of manipulation, a kind of makeup. He is a made up man. He is someone who pretends to be someone else. So he belongs to that. His lineage is that. His lineage may not be the noble lineage that has been ascribed to him, but it is a kind of dignity that is acquired, that is taken upon, not inherited. And so we find Tess a victim, a rape victim, and Alec trying to smoothen things up, explains how he is ready to accept her. But Tess is not ready for that. She from that moment, there is a slight difference in the way Tess takes charge of herself and her life. We cannot call it boldness. You cannot call it, cannot say that Tess has become a woman of the world. No, it is only necessity and need that has brought her to this point. Now, from Tantridge, we see Tess moving over to Talbothay's diary. Now, before that, in the interim, the between Tantridge and Talbothays, there is a point where Tess realizes she is pregnant. She is with child. There is the time when she delivers, and the name she gives to her child is also very significant. She calls the child Sorrow. Now, Sorrow is very significant. The name is very significant because from that point onwards, in fact, her sorrow had started earlier. From that point onwards, we see Tess going on, leading a life of sorrow, a life where she needs to be brave, needs to be to have a certain sense of fortitude, but many a times loses it. So, Sorrow is has a very short life. Sorrow dies very soon, maybe in 3 to 5 months. Sorrow dies, and the next the next phase of Tess begins. In fact, the whole novel is divided into many phases, 6 phases, where you have phases, phases, where there are stages in Tess's life. So the next stage comes where the mother Tess, the mother who is more knowledgeable about the world, who knows what is happening around her, yet cannot do anything to sort it out, finds a troubled Tess coming to Talbothays' diary. That is a diary where she again decides to continue her search for life and life's meaning, and also a struggle for existence. She comes to Talbothays' diary where she has the fortune or the misfortune of meeting a set of people who have very significant roles in their life. That is where she meets 3 friends. Now, she meets 3 people. One of them, their names are Iz, Rue, Reti. I'm not writing their surnames, Reti Priddle and Marianne. These are her 3 friends from Talbothays' diary who are soulmates to her. And there it is that she meets Angel Clare. Angel Clare, as we saw, she had a glimpse of Angel Clare in the beginning of the novel during the May Dance Festival. And the next meeting here is at Talbothays' diary, where she and Angel fall in love with each other. Now, let me tell you about Angel. Angel is a man from a family of scholars, you could call them. He is educated. He is our modern day version of an engineer who has been tooled and learned or educated in the idea of technical, technique, or rather science. So here we immediately have the confrontation between tradition and modernity. Modernity not in the sense of modernity that we have here, but in the sense of modernity as was found opposing tradition. So if that happens to be one of the themes of the novel. So if Tess represents tradition or convention or the age-old practices and customs, Angel Clare represents modernity. And so it also is linked with the economic depression that we were talking about, the depression of the 1870s, where there was a rush to come out of the depression by opening up the world, opening up England to the world, to Europe. And what we see there is the coming in of modern equipment. And that is symbolic here also. In the middle of Talbothays' diary, we have a machine called the reaping machine, and it is red in color. Now, the color red is also significant in the novel. You find the red reaping machine right in the middle of Talbot Hayes' diary, which signifies the connection or the contradiction or the opposition between tradition and modernity. So we have angel representing modernity. They fall in love with each other, and angel, in spite of his family's need or his family's demand for him to get married to someone else, he decides to choose Tess as his future wife. Now, the reason is could be Tess's beauty, could be Tess's innocence, but it is also a kind of understanding that Angel has with the world and with himself. He feels that given the kind of profession he's pursuing, given the kind of job that he's doing, Tess would be the most suitable person in his life. So this is the way in which Angel and Tess continue their love affair. It reaches a point of marriage, and there we find that Angel, he proposes to Tess, she agrees, but it is Tess she cannot do without confession. Now that is the innocence of Tess. She decides that she will not marry unless she has confessed her past to Angel. And what she does is she writes, because she finds it very difficult to say that to Angel on the face. She writes all her writes her confession in a letter, and she slips it under his door. So the next morning, it was the previous day of the marriage. The next day morning, she looks up to Angel for any sign of discomfort, for any sign of distaste or anger or any sign of rejection or whatever. And she looks up to his face, finds nothing, and assumes that he is okay with the whole thing. So they get married. They get married, and that evening, as they sit together and talk, Angel confesses to his having had an affair with an older woman while he was studying. He says that the affair was short-lived. He has nothing to do with that lady anymore. Taking courage from this confession, Tess, what she does is Tess immediately, the innocent girl that she is, she immediately confesses, and she tells the whole story and says, I think you know about it, and she tells the story. Angel's reaction is surprising to her. While she, who had taken Angel's confession as something of the past, as something that could have happened, Angel does not reciprocate. Angel immediately becomes upset. He becomes upset, and he decides that he is going to leave her. He does give her a few diamonds and some money, and says that you be here, you can go back to your parents, or you can do what you please, but I am going to be away for some time, and I will remain so until I feel that I need to talk to you or get back to you. So he specifically requests her not to contact him until he calls for her. So that is the separation of Angel from Tess. It was a one-day marriage. And after that, we find Tess again has to fend for herself. That takes her to Flintcomb Ash. Now, Flintcomb Ash is a place. Now here, there is a chance meeting between, here I can bring you the next theme of the novel. You could say it is love versus intellect. So we find Tess being the epitome of love. Her emotion and her feelings for Angel definitely overcome her, and are expressed in each of her relationships with the people whom she meets, especially with Angel. And intellect determines the ideas of angel, the way angel reacted to the confession of Tess and also to his marriage with Tess. Anyway, so this brings us to the next theme, and we find Tess at Flintcomb Ash. Now there, what we see is she is on the way, she meets a person who is preaching, a roadside preacher by the wayside. He's preaching there. She stands and watches the person for some time and finds that this person is none other than her former acquaintance cum rapist Alec Durbervil. She finds him there, who has turned a Methodist preacher. So he is preaching there to a group of people. He happens to see her too. She is you know, already there at Flintcomb Ash. He follows her there, as is obvious and as she had almost expected he would do. He follows her there and again begin a series of proposals and a series of proposals. He follows her, he pesters her, he kind of, in every way, he haunts her. He haunts her, and it is that he doesn't want, or rather Tess is not given an opportunity to say no. Not that she says yes, no, Tess does not submit. She thwarts him, rejects him, humiliates him, insults him, refuses him flat each time he proposes to her. Anyway, by that time, we see that Tess is back in touch with her family, at least Lisa Lou, her sister, is in touch with her. And also, Tess, we see through Lisa Lou, she donates, or rather contributes, whatever earnings she has been able to keep apart to her mother. So, her friend comes to Flintcomb Ash, and again she has a friend there. At least that is some kind of a consolation for Tess. So she has a friend there to whom she can confess, and from there they have conversations about Angel. There is no news of Angel. Is in touch with her, and is part of the Flintcomb Ash dairy there, and they exchange views about the marriage, where Is says that Angel has, what he has done is definitely wrong, and Tess has explained to him. Tess explains to Is what the situation was, or what happened between them. Meanwhile, Tess writes letters to Angel, where she begs him to forgive her. She says that he should understand her, that this was her situation and it was out of control. Confesses again. She apologizes many times, but there is no response from Angel. Finally, she writes an angry letter to Angel, saying that he has been very cruel to her, and that he must forgive her. Please forget me. Please forget me. You have not understood me. You have not understood my faithfulness, etc., etc. Meanwhile, there is an incident. Is has to travel out of this place, and she somehow meets Angel on a journey to that place. She meets Angel, who had come down to his house for a visit, and on his way back, Is meets Angel, and there on a whim, Angel requests Is to follow him and accompany him back to the place where he's working. Is accepts, because at present Angel is not tied up with Tess, so she finds Angel free, so she accepts. But meanwhile, they get talking, and in the conversation, Is realizes that Angel is still not clear about his relationship with Tess, nor does he totally want to reject and do away or dispose of Tess. So she is confused about their relationship, and this makes her feel that she is doing something wrong. So they do not, the things don't go much further, they separate, and Iz comes and confesses to Tess also what has happened. Tess doesn't give much of a, doesn't have much of a problem with that, because there is this honesty, an essential honesty and goodness in Tess, which makes her forgive and forget all those whom she loves. Now, meanwhile, there is a communication between Angel's family and Tess, where Tess is requested to come and visit them. So Angel has two brothers. One brother is called Felix, and it is there that Tess gets to know Angel's family. The father is a parson, Reverend James Clare. His mother is there, and also two brothers. Now there is also a third person called Mercy Chant. I'm not writing down the name there. Mercy Chant again represents the kind of life that his family had chosen for Angel. They had wanted him to marry Mercy Chant, again a woman who has been educated in theology and who teaches in, also is a teacher, so village teacher. So he has refused the marriage, we know that, that's why he married Tess. So in spite of the fact we meet Mercy there, and the family has fixed Felix's marriage with Mercy. They meet there, Tess comes there, visits them, but somehow she overhears this conversation between the brothers and their father and mother, that what Tess has done has been silly and stupid, and that Tess is to blame in this for the separation between their son and her and Tess. So she is very sorry that she even went there. She comes back from Angel's village and back to Flintcomb Ash. Now here, as I said, the pursuit of Alec becomes almost intolerable, and then suddenly we see Angel. Angel has decided that he is no more, he has decided that he wants Tess back. He doesn't feel, he has been, some kind of decision on his part makes him come back from the place that he had gone to study, come back to his village. He had gone to Brazil. So from Brazil, he comes back to his village and decides to make it up with Tess. That is the next step, where Angel comes back, and here Tess, we do not see Tess for a certain period of time. A certain point of time, we lose connection with Tess, and the next thing we find her is Angel going in search of Tess to her house at Marlott. He goes to her house. By that time, I forgot to tell you something. After John Derbyfield's death, the family is evicted. The mother, the little brother, and the little sister are evicted from Marlott, and they are shifted to a mansion. Remains, or to a village where they can see the remains of a mansion that had once belonged to the Durbervilles. So they are staying there in a dilapidated old house. They don't have money, their condition hasn't improved, it's still the same, and that is how so they are not there at Marlott anymore. Angel finds out their whereabouts, comes, meets them, and from there he asks them where Tess is. Lisa Lou, who has been in touch with Tess, tells him that she has moved to Sandbourne. That is the next destination of Tess of the Durbervilles. She has moved to Sandbourne, where he follows her there. he sees Tess, he opens and he finds that Tess is living in a very beautiful apartment, in a very fashionable place. He knocks on the door, someone comes and opens it, and he can't recognize Tess anymore. Tess is a woman of the world. In fact, she is dressed in a very stylish, beautiful clothes. Tess, her hairstyle has changed, the way she behaves has also kind of changed, in the way she has acquired some sense of strength or some sense of independence. What it is clear later on. Now he, Angel tells her that he has come back for her. Tess says, "You are too late," because she has already accepted Alex's offer of a marriage, or Alex's offer, and she is staying with Alec as his mistress, wife, whatever. So he's staying there. They have not legally married, but she's staying with him. And now Angel, the moment Tess sees Angel, all her defenses crumble. She is once again the innocent, lovely, pure, impetuous girl that we have met much earlier. And she goes back. Angel to go back. She herself goes into the house, and then we see the housekeeper. Now the rest of the story, or rest of that incident, is narrated by the housekeeper of that house where Alec and Tess are living right now. So the what we hear from the housekeeper, who sees the whole scene through the keyhole of the door, of their bedroom door, she sees this, she hears how Tess and Alec have a massive argument. There's an argument, they have, almost fight, you know, it's an open fight, and where Tess asks Alec to move away, or to move out of her life, and that she is going back to Angel anyway, which of course he doesn't allow. And the next thing that we see is, which even the housekeeper doesn't see, because she hears this loud noise, and at a point of time when the volume is too high, she moves back, and she doesn't see what happens later. In fact, she sees it, she goes back downstairs, and she sees Tess leaving the house. You see her leaving the house, and the housekeeper looks up just like that, and finds a red stain on this white ceiling. So that is why I said the color red and the color white are again part of the theme of Tess. The color red representing modernity, or rather not modernity, it represents something opposing white. The purity of white is offset by the strength and the boldness of the color red. And red here, she sees blood spreading on the ceiling. She goes up to find Alec murdered. Angel runs back to, Tess runs back to Angel, saying that this is it. I have done away with Alec, and you, I have come back to you. Now Angel is happy at having got back Tess. They know they have to hide. They know they have to run. And Angel is, you know, he supports the idea, and he wants to protect Tess. And they also realize that going outside the place would be dangerous, so they wait around inland. They wait in and around the inner regions of Sanborn until they have a chance to escape. Now that is how we find them spending 3 days. I'm sorry, I think it is 5 days. 5 days of eternal of extensive happiness. They are together, they are in love with each other, they forget all their past, they try to forget what is going to happen in the future, and they are together in every way. These are the five most happy days that Tess has ever had in her life. From a lifetime of poverty to an experience of deception, to this point of time when she has murdered someone, we find Tess experiencing real bliss and happiness in Sanborn for 5 days. Just 5 days, her days are numbered. We know the police is searching for her. From Sanborn, they run. They run, try to escape, and they come to a place called Stonehenge. Now, Stonehenge is a very strategic point here where you have them coming, and that is the place where Tess decides to, she's tired of running. She's tired of running. She says, she cries out for rest. Angel says, okay, you can rest here. She falls asleep in Stonehenge in a very isolated, you know, it's a, some kind of a top of a mountain. Sleeps there under a ledge. There is nature all around. See, the whole novel is filled with mention of nature. Nature encompasses the whole novel. Comprehensive intrusion, not intrusion, it is a very natural cohabitation between man and nature. And that is why Thomas Hardy has also been called someone uplifted, or rather always try to bring about this close association and project that through his novels. In fact, we also must remember that Thomas Hardy has kind of invented, or rather has invented or constructed a locale for himself, where he places most of the stories of his novels, in this place called Wessex, which is a county which is connected to the counties of Dorset and Lancaster, etc. So Wessex is his permanent locale for most of his novels. So here, that's why we see novel nature. I'll speak about that as I finish. Stonehenge is the place where Tess rests, and that is the place where the police come. That is the place where Tess is convicted. She is imprisoned, and that is the place where Tess and Angel separate. That is again the place of no return, and the place from where Angel moves back. That's the point of no return. You find the next thing you find is Tess, before she leaves, she extracts a promise from Angel asking him to forget her, or rather to continue his life, not to stop with this, continue his life and marry Lisa Lou, her sister, so that he can be a support to her family too. That is one intention, the goodness of Tess, which remains with her until she dies, and also a hope that Angel will finally discover happiness. The next scene we see, or the rather the last scene of the novel, is where we find Lisa Lou and Angel standing apart and looking up over the mountain where the execution of Tess is happening. They see a black flag over the prison, a black which signifies the execution of Tess early in the morning. The last lines of the novel are very significant. We have the last lines are this. The president of the immortals had his sport with Tess. The president of the immortals had finished his sport with Tess. Now, here again, we come to the very most important theme of the novel, which is fate. Fate and the will to live. Fate and life, you could call it the will to live, where you find fate playing an important role in her life, in their lives. And in fact, through the whole novel, we find the importance of fate. The death of Prince is the beginning, or rather even before that, the knowledge that d'Urberville is a family that is to be, a name that is to be associated with Tess. The fact that Prince dies and their misfortune begins begins, and they can do nothing about it. The fact that Alec rapes Tess, she can do nothing about it because she's totally unaware of what happened. It is only that we find nature, the whole of the forest, the trees, the plants mourning there. There is rain, and the novelist Thomas Hardy predicts, or rather explains, how the whole of nature mourns for the lot of Tess. And then we find the birth of her son, the sorrow, the death of the child, her shift from each destination, one destination to the other, until the last destination gobbles her up, engulfs her, and she can do nothing. She cannot experience happiness, she cannot experience joy, she cannot experience motherhood. And so Tess has a life that is that has been carried by someone to somewhere, until she is deposited in a hangman's place, going on to, you know, death. So these are the themes of the novel, these are the destinations, and we also see that certain things that would be interesting are how Thomas Hardy was actually, he had the inspiration of Tess when he witnessed an execution as a young child. They say that he saw a woman named Martha Brown being executed, and that could have brought in him this story of the final execution of Tess. Something else that I'd like to tell you, that Tess was initially published in serial form, in a magazine called the Graphic magazine in 1890, somewhere around before 1891. It came in serialized form. In fact, the editors and the publishers of the magazine did not like the story that Thomas Hardy presented. They were not happy with Tess. In fact, they terribly reacted against the subtitle too. They made significant changes in the novel, and of course Thomas Hardy wasn't happy about it, until the first publication of the novel came in three volumes in 1891, and these three volumes again did not carry the essence of the novel as Thomas Hardy had envisaged. And finally, the 1892 edition was the novel which Thomas Hardy had envisaged, which had the subtitle, which of course had created a lot of controversy, but which Thomas Hardy stuck because he wanted to project this idea that Tess for him was pure. And purity did not mean that a woman, just because a woman was raped, she was not pure. So in that way, we come to another theme of the novel, which could be the feminist progressiveness. Now, if you call Tess a feminist, many of us would doubt, would not agree. But she is a feminist in the term that she is someone who has gone out of her house to fend for herself, fend for her family, braving all the odds, braving all the storms in life. Plus, towards the end, according to the kind of conviction or the kind of practice that the society of England or London at that point of time was in their village, especially a woman who was independent, who had money with herself, was someone who was progressive and someone who was capable of taking care of the world, or what you would call a woman of the world. And in that sense, Tess is a feminist. Of course, we see her move towards progression, move to fend for herself, to become a lady. How she becomes a lady of the world, though the lady of the world never suits Tess, because she is still innocent. And that is the contrast. How till the very end, in spite of all that happens to her, Thomas Hardy still maintains the purity, the whiteness of Tess, as in contrast to the redness that is rampant around. So tradition and modernity, the pervasive interference of fate in every phase of life. The ideas of feminism, the tradition, modernity, love and intellect, all these are the themes that move in and around Tess. And there is something else. In fact, Thomas Hardy had wanted to publish, present Tess as a play. In fact, there was this he had told his story to a director, and the wife of that director, the director urged him, her name was Sharon Tate, and the wife of the director urged him to urged her husband to present this as a play. That is before it was published, before in 1891. She was cruelly murdered on the evening of, one evening. She was pregnant and she was murdered with child. And so that didn't happen, and finally it came out as a book. I hope you have understood the novel, got some idea about the novel. Let's come, I'll meet you back in our classroom. Meanwhile, I hope you will see this video and would understand Tess better. Thank you so much.